When were you first exposed to ideas of the occult and Aleister Crowley in particular?
I wasn't particularly aware in school of the intellectual side of it, but I think that I've always, you know, had an empathy or a feeling that there were forces and eddies and ripples and things that influenced the normal run of events that were not recognized, you know, by, you know, Western society, and those things were not satisfactorily explained by, you know, the literature about ghosts or about poltergeists or about astrology or about any of those relatively simplistic pseudosciences that attempt to go some way to explaining why some days are good and some days are not. And so when I met, actually it wasn't really till I met John that I learnt what little I do know about the kind of history and the sort of intellectual side of it. And largely that interest came about through our interest in the work of Austin Osman Spare, who was an occult artist who lived in London from the late 19th century till I think he died in 1956. And he was a kind of follower of Crowley and for a while there, and he was a kind of a shamanistic artist, and his pictures are great, and you know, and we started collecting those at the same time as.
What do they look like?
The early ones look a little bit like Aubrey Beardsley, and with a kind of William Blake kind of overtones. When he was studying, he went to art college, and his early stuff looks like that, and then he became an official war artist during the First World War, and so painted and drew and painted large canvases of the horror of the Ypres and all that. And after that, having had that experience, his work kind of splintered off into several deranged kind of offshoots. For a long time, he painted, drew. Hollywood movie stars, but in a sort of very what he called sidereal, which was the drawings were sort of distorted along different planes, and so it was almost like he was taking a flat photograph of Spencer Tracy or whatever and turning it at an on angle and redrawing it, so it was like he was trying to perceive something beneath the surface of the image. And from there, his work became almost psychedelic in the traditional sense of being very bright colors and very very vivid, and with many different elements of animals and strange African faces and automatic writing.
Okay.
And that was before, you know, LSD was ever synthesized. So he was the kind of the one who opened the door to my interest in the sort of classical occult tradition, if you like. And in fact, to this day, I wouldn't regard myself as any kind of an expert in that, but I do think that the whatever it is, the 9/10 of the brain that we currently don't have an explanation for, you know, is continues to work, you know, still it's doing stuff. It's just we haven't learnt how to quite to train it to do what we want. And some, you know, in 100 years' time, maybe people have figured that out.
Putting all these ideas into a sonic sort of context or song context, it poses, you know, several challenges. What are some of those challenges?
Well, it's never been our intention to to kind of prophesize or to kind of preach or to try and say to people, you know, wake up, you need to be thinking about this occult thing, or you need to be, you know, protesting against the use of, you know, dolphins in war or whatever. You know, we've never been great agitprop exponents, but at the same time, you know, the music that we make comes from, as you were saying before, a kind of the, you know, the part of the soul that's not normally on public display. And so it's inevitable that the things, the subjects that interest us are, you know, are going to bubble to the surface and to be sources of, you know, John, you know, for John, the sources of words, and for me, they tend to be more sort of sources of atmosphere or mood that, you know, goes through phases of being angry, you know, calmer, introspective, depressed, happy, sad, you know. So I tend not so much to contribute to the words, but more to the actual flow of the sound, if you like.
Okay.
So it's not that we actually try. I mean, I think it would be more or less impossible to try and take those things that we were just talking about and sort of reduce them to a couplet.
Mm.
Well, I certainly don't have.
No, but talent. There's, you know, things like psychoacoustics, right? And even the Music in the Dark project. I mean, if sensory deprivation, you know, causes all kinds of sorts of audio things to happen that might be in line with a lot of these ideas as well, right?
Yeah, that's true. I think with, you know, the direct connection between frequency and physical response was something that we investigated in Throbbing Gristle quite a bit, and had large speakers and audio systems that went beyond the normal range of you know, a regular PA or hi-fi. And in doing so, the members of Throbbing Gristle, myself and Chris and Cozy and Genesis, were, you know, quite often physically sick or had, you know, optical, you know, tunneling effects and, you know, things that could be regarded as probably not very good for one's health.
Yeah.
And so when Throbbing Gristle was terminated in the early 80s, I sort of felt that I'd done that, and I was more interested in the more subtle things that you could do with sound, and the way that, for example, harmony or the lack of it can lead you along a path. And certainly in the music that we've been doing most recently, I'm interested more in, you know, making music that leads people along a path to a new place that they may not have seen before, but not, you know, not as a method to hit them on the head with any particular effect or particular, you know, alarming physical sensation.